Hi folks, CodeTutor here, and my name is Anil Deshpande. Hi folks, let's get started with another new topic in Android development. Let's revisit one of the applications that we had implemented when we were learning Jetpack Compose. If you recall, this is the application that we had implemented, which was basically a scrollable view of cards displaying information about countries like the flag, capital of the country, currency, etc., etc. Well, we are going to revisit this application, but we will flush it out with concepts that we have learned previously, that is side effects and a couple of more things. Let me show you what do I mean by that. If I run this particular application from the beginning, you will see that now it takes a little bit of time to load the information because it is basically fetching it from the API, that is from the server. However, next time when I launch the application again, now you will observe that it quickly loads data. This time it doesn't take much time. What exactly is happening? Well, time to get into the nitty-gritty details. So when you start the application, the first thing that we do is check whether the database is there locally on the device. If it is present, then we will fetch the data from the local database and then render it on the app. And because the data is immediately available in the local database, this should not take much time. That is the reason why second time when I launched the app, the data appeared much quickly on the screen. However, if the data is not present, then I have to make an API call to fetch the data. And during that time, I will have to show a busy symbol. Once I get the data, you have to save the data to the local database. And then you have to fetch the data from the local database to render the data again on the screen. From the end user's perspective, all that matters is data is there. Whether it is getting rendered from the local database or whether from the API call, that doesn't really matter. This in industry parlance is also called as offline first approach to the app building. To what extent you want to do it really depends upon your application requirement. But this is the basic gist of it. Now, what we will do is in this whole flow, we will mainly be concentrating on the database, that is how to save the data to the local database, how to fetch the data from the database and render it on the screen. If you are wondering what that database is, it is Room. Room is not really a database. It is a persistence library which wraps around the database, which is SQLite database. But of course, we cannot isolate ourselves while discussing with Room only to the Room database. We may have to visit to some extent how to fetch the data via REST API, or at least to some extent see how this happens. The reason why we need to understand it is the data that you might be getting from the API is JSON, but the data that you will be storing internally in the SQLite database on which the Room is wrapped, that is in a different format. So we will have to understand how this conversion from JSON to SQLite 3 also happens. So that is also very much part of understanding how to work with Room persistence library. When you look at the official documentation of the Room, it clearly states that Room is a persistence library that provides an abstraction layer over the SQLite to allow fluent database access while harnessing the full power of SQLite. What is SQLite? SQLite is a embedded database that is mainly used for storing relational database on the mobile device. It is a lightweight relational database specifically meant for lightweight applications, typically like a mobile application. If you have been following CodeTutor for a long time, I have covered SQLite in a much more detailed manner in one of the earlier older series. So I won't be going through the SQLite details now, but if you want to visit, please feel free to visit and watch those videos on SQLite itself, and then you can come back here. But regardless of whether you know SQLite or not, when you are trying to learn Room, you will have a lot of questions like how to set up the Room database, how do I create the database tables and columns in that particular database? How to fetch the data from the room? Where can I see this data on the device? And how do I query it? If these are the questions from the SQLite database itself, then there are other legitimate questions when you are dealing with storing the data. That is, how do I insert the data from the API into the room? How to convert JSON into a SQLite? Because those are two different data formats. How to address the data compatibility issues? Because once again, the data types supported by JSON and from SQLite are different. And how do I insert the data in the room? So when you put a developer hat, if the end goal is to create a database, what are the preceding steps that you have to do to end up with a database? It is very, very important that you understand these preceding steps. To create a database, first you have to create a data access object, or DAO in short. But to create a data access object, you have to create an entity. If you are wondering what is an entity, entity is nothing but a class which represents the column structure in the database. So you will have to decide the entity and pass it to data access object. But once again, to create an entity, it is not a straightforward step, because the data that you might be getting from the API might not be compatible with the SQLite. In that case, you have to convert it into a SQLite compatible data. For that, you will have to use a converter with the entity. So once you have this setup ready, then you have to use it with the repository. And it is this repository which will be used in the view model, and this view model will be used by the composable. This is how the whole structure looks like. Anything that you see from the repository to the database is all about isolation of the data management logic. And then composable and view model is all about view and view's state management. In this way, you maintain the isolation of two separate concerns, that is managing the view and view state and managing the data itself. Needless to say, as we learn how to work with room and all these different concepts, we will be revisiting some of the older concepts like working with the view model and repository. Whatever that we will be covering will be in compliance with the MEVM architecture that we have covered earlier as well. So let me stop here. Get ready for the series on room persistence library in Android development. That brings us to the end of this particular video. Don't forget to like, comment, share the video, and subscribe to the channel. Take care. Bye.